from Doctors for Choice.
That's what.
It's probably you, the one up there.
That's what.
I'll flick it every now and again. My name is Peadar O Grady and I'm from Doctors for Choice. We're an organisation of doctors who believe that consent is a crucial central factor in healthcare. We believe that trusting the patient is a fairly, if there's anything sacred in medicine, it is trust. There is an old expression in the patient rights. In the patient rights tradition, which says nothing about us without us. And we think that that's a fundamental universal principle. We don't think there are exceptions to it. And we don't think that reproductive healthcare should be an exception to the notion of consent and of trust between health worker and service user. So I'm just going to quickly show a few photographs. There's a history to the struggle. Okay? We're fighting, Claire and Mandy talked about Repeal the 8th campaign. But there have been campaigns before. This is a campaign from the, I think, late 80s. Which was about ensuring that anybody who did want to travel to England to avail of abortions there, abortion became legal in Britain in following the 1967 Act. And this is a group of campaigners who are basically making the phone number available for people so that they can phone and arrange an abortion in the UK. This is in the late 80s. And it was illegal to do that. So you can see that each of them is just holding one number so that they, you know, they could be arrested for being in possession of the number 6, but not. And they used to sing songs 6774700 to get the phone number available. Okay? And there were a lot of harassment of them for doing so, but I just thought I would remind us that people fought before in quite brave ways. This is the demonstration that happened in 1992 after the state locked up a 14-year-old child who'd been raped and attempted to force her to carry her pregnancy through to the end. And that's what happened. And that's why she accessed an abortion. The first court ruling was that she was to be locked up by the state for the duration of her pregnancy and not allowed to go to England. That happened, and there was a second court judgment which said, actually, even though the Eighth Amendment says that there's an equal right between the fetus and the mother, the pregnant child who's carrying the fetus, if this child kills herself, then both I find it even hard to talk about there being a separation between a pregnant woman and a fetus, like they're two separate entities, because they're not, they're connected. But this was the protest that happened to say you cannot have a child and force that child through pregnancy. This was a demonstration which happened when, in 2002, the state put again another referendum to try to remove suicide risk as a reason for having an abortion, as in to reverse the Supreme Court ruling that had allowed the 14-year-old child to have an abortion. And the X case, that's the 14-year-old, could have had that abortion in Ireland, but of course didn't, because we had no abortion services in Ireland. This is the demonstration that happened after Savita Hanapalavar died. Better view of it is that photograph, which I think is fantastic. I love looking at that photograph because it makes me... I grew up in the 1960s and 70s in Ireland, and we were dominated by the Catholic Church. When I first heard about the Taliban in Afghanistan, I was giving out their fundamentalists, and they tell everyone what to do, and women don't have rights. That was 1960s Ireland. We were policed by the church. But this demonstration showed me that when a woman died, because Irish, the threat of imprisonment under the 1861 Act was so great that people were literally leaving it till the last moment. A woman was very sick, she was miscarrying, fetus was going to die. But as long as they could hear a heartbeat, there was fear. And she died because they didn't intervene. She begged. She didn't just ask for an abortion. She asked repeatedly for an abortion. And one of the leading obstetricians, Peter Boylan, has made it very clear. If she'd had an abortion, she'd still be alive today. And I think that response was fantastic. And it's, you know, part of why we're here now talking to you. Part of it, it's not the only reason. But that showed that things are changing. Well, the behaviour of the obstetric units is still putting women's lives at risk. There is a huge section of the population that doesn't agree with that. Okay, so Doctors for Choice, again, comes from the point of view that there is nothing exceptional about women who choose to have an abortion. It's part of reproductive healthcare, it's part of healthcare. And there is no reason why principles, good principles that apply to good healthcare, shouldn't apply to women who have unwanted pregnancies. I mean, in general, we advocate patient-centered care, and that women need patient-centered care with the same principles of respect, which is now taught as good practice. This wasn't always true, and to a certain extent isn't always true. There's still paternalism, there's still patronizing behavior by health staff, patients are still not listened to when they're sick, when they're in need, and so on. But there has been some change in that at least a lot of doctors now accept that this is what they should be doing. And what we are arguing is that women who choose an abortion are patients like any other. What we need from people is we need their consent. Consent is the only restriction which should exist on access to services. If somebody does not give consent, then it is only in the most exceptional circumstances that you treat them. And they're only in circumstances where you're absolutely certain that they do not have the capacity to make a decision. Okay, so if I was in a car crash and a head injury and I was unconscious, I would hope that all the staff, and they, if they had time, consult with my family or friends or whatever, and make decisions for me because I lack the capacity to consent. But you have to be very clear that somebody does not consent. And I think one of the most poignant questions that we can ask is there some way in which the medical profession or the religious legal, political classes are saying to us that actually patients can consent to treatment in all circumstances except when they lack capacity, and pregnant women lack the capacity to give consent. Now, nobody says those actual words, but it is one of the only real considerations as to why this is an exception. Besides this argument that the anti-choice side have literally invented, is that there are two patients. And this is, while I never want to dismiss somebody's opinion as ungrounded or, you know, needing to be dismissed in some way, but this is a really eccentric view internationally. Not many medics, not many people, to be honest, share that view. But if people have that view, I thoroughly respect it, and if the patient I'm dealing with has that view, I will respect that view. However, forcing other people to have that view is politically, well, you could say it's politically eccentric. It's in many ways what we call politically right-wing. Forcing your view on other people, despite the fact that you know that they have a valid right to reject that view. So if you want to take, there are two patients, the pregnant woman and the fetus, and if you want to reject that notion, you should be entitled to it. And if doctors and health workers will respect both people with both views. Politically, however, we don't think this patient should be able to tell that patient what to do. The only thing we need around access is we need facilities. Currently, medications are illegal in Ireland. Certainly, they're illegal for people to access when they want to have an abortion. We reckon about 4,000 women travel for abortions every year. Now, Claire was saying, you know, we have abortion in Ireland, it just doesn't happen here. Like, Irish people have abortions, they go abroad and come back. That is changing slightly on the illegal side. In the bad old days, backstreet abortions were very dangerous, they were unsafe, they weren't usually performed in circumstances that were clean enough, where the person performing them was skilled enough, and the disability and death that followed from unsafe abortions was very great. However, the modern equivalent of a backstreet abortion, an illegal abortion, that is currently happening a lot in Ireland, is the use of the abortion pill. If you go on womenhelp.org, womenhelp.org, they will send you abortion pills within 7 days. You can take them at home, and if you have trouble with bleeding, fever, you can go to your doctor or accident emergency department and tell them you are having a miscarriage. Whether you tell them that you took abortion pills or not makes no difference. Makes no difference to your care. The British Pregnancy Advice Service offer a telephone service to Ireland. So if you've taken the pills and you ring them, they will give you telephone advice. Before you take them, there is very, very good advice on the internet about how you can take them safely. Now, that doesn't make it okay. You should still be able to go and discuss with your doctor before you take the pill, while you're taking the pill, after you take the pill, if you want to. But in Ireland, because what you're doing is illegal, you cannot do that. And we believe that's wrong, but we observe that more and more women are doing this, and that it is at least as safe as the abortion services that are being provided in Britain, if it's done early, before 9 weeks. That's a big change. Doctors can provide it, but women themselves can access it through the internet, womenhelp.org. 7 days, you'll have it. British Pregnancy Advisory Service gives a backup service, and you can go to casualty or your doctor if you run into trouble. And it is exceptionally rare that you have any significant side effects in early pregnancy with medical abortion. medical abortion has the lowest rate of side effects. But we need all the other facilities as well. We currently don't have them. Okay, so getting on to the what do we need from doctors' point of view, what do we need from the law? And the only thing that we need from the law is that it doesn't get in the way. There was a case, I think last year, where a woman died while pregnant, and the family, the woman's partner and so on, everyone was agreed, the doctors, everybody agreed the machine should be turned off and continued life support for a woman who was dead should not be continued. And the doctors were sitting at the woman's bedside with a copy of the Constitution, reading the Eighth Amendment, wondering what should they do next. And in many ways, I think that's a good example of the law getting in the way of where health workers and family are content that the best possible care has been given, and yet the law is getting in the way. Certainly, the law restricting access is not required by physicians. Okay? If a person has made an informed decision to have an abortion, and you're happy that there's consent, and they've had adequate time to receive counselling, to think about it and make their decision. This notion that it's the hardest decision ever, I'd just like to briefly comment on. Claire described one of the hardest decisions that we encounter, and that is fatal fetal abnormalities, because that's generally where somebody makes where they make the decision to have the abortion knowing that it's a fatal fetal abnormality, is usually in the setting where they have wanted that pregnancy. They were planning to have that child, and then they have to change their minds and opt for an abortion. And that is one of the most difficult decisions in choosing an abortion that we usually experience. For some people, it's not a difficult decision. It's a decision that comes to them quickly. They think, I do not want to be pregnant, I do not want to have a child. It does not take them long to make that decision, and when they have the abortion, they feel relieved that an unwanted pregnancy has been avoided. I would argue that in the last 50 years, one of the greatest advances we've had is birth control. From contraception, the morning after pill, early medical abortion, and later medical and surgical abortion, or surgical abortions, if necessary. There's a saying in abortion services that abortions should be as early as possible, but as late as necessary. And it is much better than when the earliest abortion, in some ways, is the morning after pill, and contraception better still. But there will always be a need for abortion. Unwanted pregnancies will happen, no matter how good contraception services are. Okay, and we believe that the only person who should give consent is a woman, not a priest, a doctor, a judge, or anybody else. Okay, this is the London Declaration. I'm not going to talk much about it except to say, if you see there in the middle, women are the only ones who can make the right decision for themselves. Now, if you change the word woman to the patient, okay, that's a universal principle. And again, I'm just hammering home the notion that we see no reason why women should be an exception to this rule. Claire has talked a good bit about this, so I won't talk much, except maybe to mention the British 1861 Act. I'm fairly sure it was the act that Oscar Wilde was prosecuted under. It was a whole raft of things that were sexual behaviours that were deemed to be offensive to Victorian society. And it's important to remember that the Act, actually the 1922 Offences Against the Person Act in Ireland, was just the translation of the British Act. People often say this is all about religion and it's all about Catholicism. Well, it's not, because the 1861 Act was passed by a parliament that was mainly Protestant. Okay? Or then you can say, well, it's mainly Christian. Well, it is and it isn't. It is about using politics to control people's behaviour, particularly their sexual behaviour, and particularly women when it comes The 1992, the Supreme Court X case Claire has talked about, the PLDPA, the Protection of Life During Pregnancy Act, made a minuscule change to allowing abortion in very, very, very restricted circumstances. Less than 1% of abortions are carried out, were carried out last year under the PLDPA. Okay, so restricting access, this is what we're trying to emphasize in Doctors for Choice. Restricting access is not safe. Okay? Why do we keep saying trust women? A woman makes it's a woman's right to choose, what some of the more right-wing commentators call abortion on demand. Like women have to thump the table and shout when they ask for an abortion. But if a woman decides that an abortion is the best decision for her, why is it the case that why is it that anybody wants to restrict it, firstly? But what's wrong with restricting? If someone says, yeah, no, we should stop women who don't have a good reason, where there isn't violence, or there isn't a fatal fetal abnormality, or there isn't some other good reason that they think of. And one of the reasons that we're trying to draw attention to is restricting access to abortion actually disables and kills women. Right? That's one reason. The second reason is the last one. I think it's the most ironic thing. In countries with the most restrictive laws, you have higher rates of abortions. Not just higher rates of dangerous abortions, which you do, and that's why women are disabled and are killed by restrictive laws, but you actually have more abortions. And one of the reasons is if you've good abortion services, you will have good contraceptive morning after pill services also. Okay, the biggest problem though with restriction is you just delay the procedure, you do not stop it. The abortions that Irish women have when they travel are more complicated in general than the population of usually Britain. Some abortions happen in the Netherlands or Spain or whatever. But they're more complicated than British pregnant abortions otherwise, just because they're more delayed. And the more you delay the abortion, the more complicated it gets. We're not like days and weeks, doesn't matter one. When it gets into months of delay, it matters a lot. I'm nearly finished. I'm just going to say about late abortions. Late abortions are very rare. The anti-choice side talks a lot about late abortions. And again, just as I've said, you get more late abortions when you restrict abortion, not the other way around. If you don't restrict abortion, you get late abortions. They're very rare. 99% of abortions happen before 20 weeks of gestation, before 5 months, and less than 1 in 1,000 happen after 26 weeks. 26 weeks is quite rare. And again, as I said, as early as possible, as late as necessary is the year. So finally, who decides? Who decides is a political decision? I don't believe that it's a medical decision. Somebody says, look, we've decided as a people that there will be certain restrictions on doctors. I'm going to have to put up with it. That's a political decision. I might agree with them, but I'm going to have to put up with it. So that means that we're making an appeal to people. We need your help. We need your help to apply the same principles to women as to every other patient when it comes to making the best decision about their pregnancy. Okay? Because otherwise you either get travel and all the expense and humiliation of it, or you get unsafe abortions. And I have to add, and increasingly, and I'm delighted about this, we're getting safe illegal abortions. Those two words usually go together in the past. Okay? If it was illegal, it was generally unsafe. Dodgy, it was not in a good setting, not with a well-trained person, and not with, you know, good facilities. Illegal abortions that are done with the abortion pill are increasingly safe. And it becomes increasingly ridiculous to be criminalising people for behaviour that is freely chosen and carried out safely. Okay, and finally, there is no medical basis, I think I've repeated that enough, for exceptions to consent, and there is no medical basis for restrictions based on access. In a lot of countries in the world, you have doctors certifying whether a woman deserves or does not deserve an abortion. That is a doctor carrying out a political task. There is no medical basis for doing it, and in fact, as I've said, there is quite a lot of medical evidence that you should not do it. Restricting access to abortions is dangerous, but it's not safe. Okay, so there's lots of political actions. All I'm going to finish by saying is there are lots of ways of getting involved. You can get involved through political parties, through trade unions, through abortion rights groups, and so on. And I would really strongly encourage you, we're going to need as many people as possible. If we're going to repeal the Eighth Amendment and decriminalise, stop threatening women and health workers with 14 years in prison. If people feel that the fetus has an equal right to life as they do, then they will be treated with respect in the health service. If they don't agree with that, and they think that they will choose to continue, they will choose to have a child when and if they have a child, when and if they continue with the pregnancy, is their decision. They should also be treated with respect in the health service. So if we respect one choice, we should respect the other. There aren't good grounds for it medically. So this is over to you. This is a political question for you. Are you going to allow the opinion of one small group in our society to be forced on women? Or do you think that women, like every other patient, when they have a medical decision to make, they should make it, the final decision should be theirs. They should have as much help and information as possible, but the final decision, like every other patient, should be theirs. We think that it should. We think we need to repeal the Eighth Amendment and then decriminalise, take the LDPA away, take the threat of prison away, and let people get on with their lives, making decisions we know they are well capable of making. Trust the patient, trust women to decide, get rid of this restrictive and coercive and brutal legislation. Thanks very much.